I'm in a new province, and this week we're going to find out if Divest and Dark Bargain are possibly Pauper playable. Divest and Dark Bargain are two brand new cards from Dominaria. They're very controlling by nature, manipulating your opponent's hand and filling your own back up. I'm confident in the power of these spells, but I wasn't completely sure about where they would fit until I saw Dark Hellkite's recent 5-0 finish with this deck, Rakdos Alchemist. Rakdos midrange or control decks aren't alien to the Pauper metagame. They occasionally go 5-0, and I've even played a list like this before, put forward by another Pauper community member who goes by the name Tassanara. So congratulations on your 5-0 Dark Hellkite, and I am so sorry for potentially butchering your name, Tass. I'm going to start the deck tech out by explaining the cards we're building around this week. First we have Divest, which costs 1 black mana for a sorcery that causes target player to reveal their hand. You choose an artifact or creature card from it, that player discards that card. I talked a little bit about why I think this card is so powerful in my Dominaria set review. You can disrupt an aggressive deck's curve out by taking one of their best creatures. You can strip a potential 2-for-1 out of a Delver opponent's hand, like an Augur of Bolas or a Spellstutter Sprite. You can even use Divest to keep Boros Monarch or Affinity off their land drops. The other card we're trying out is Dark Bargain. It costs 3 and a black for an instant, which is important. You look at the top 3 cards of your library, put 2 of them into your hand, and the other into your graveyard. Dark Bargain deals 2 damage to you. There are a couple of cards that you can readily compare to Dark Bargain. First, we have Read the Bones, which costs 1 less, but it's sorcery speed, and it gives you just a little bit less selection over the cards you put into your hand. We also have Bitter Revelation, which is very similar to Dark Bargain, only it lets you dig 4 cards deep at sorcery speed. Dark Bargain's advantage over cards like that in this deck is that it's instant speed. You might want to be holding up one of your interactive spells or trigger your Thermo Alchemists to surprise your opponent. Both of these cards can be used to help you steamroll card advantage over your opponent. I'll explain the rest of the card advantage we're playing in this deck next. First, we have Thorn of the Black Rose, which costs 3 and a black for a 1/3 with Death Touch. When it enters the battlefield, you become the Monarch, which means you draw an extra card at the beginning of each of your end steps. If someone deals damage to you that isn't the Monarch, they become the Monarch and get to draw another card at the beginning of each of their end steps. While it's a dangerous notion to introduce a Howling Mind to any battlefield, our deck is really built around heavy interaction. We should be able to keep most of our opponent's creatures off the board and block whatever they have left with our own creatures. Next we have Knight's Whisper, which gives you a lot less selection but is also a lot cheaper than Dark Bargain. It costs 1 and a black for a sorcery that draws you 2 cards and loses you 2 life. Finally, we have Phyrexian Rager, one of the best pieces of card advantage on a stick that these colors have access to. It costs 2 and a black for a 2/2, and when it enters the battlefield, you draw a card and lose a life. Our next spell is just some powerful card filtering that you can cast twice. It's Faithless Looting. It costs 1 red for a sorcery. You draw 2 cards, then discard 2 cards. You can flash it back out of your graveyard by paying 2 and a red. Next is Liliana's Spectre, that looks a lot more at home in the discard department with Divest than it does alongside the rest of the card advantage cards. However, if you leverage it properly, this can turn into a proper 2-for-1. Liliana's Spectre costs 1 black black for a 2/1 flyer, and when it enters the battlefield, each opponent discards a card. I'm going to talk about one of the biggest draws to this color pair in Pauper next. It's the raw interactive power of the Rakdos Guild. First, we have Chainer's Edict, which costs 1 and a black for a sorcery that makes target player sacrifice a creature. You can flash it back out of your graveyard by paying 5 black black. We're also running one of the most powerful removal spells in the Pauper format, something Michael Jacob alludes to often. This is Terminate. It costs black red for an instant that destroys target creature. It can't be regenerated. Finally, we have Arc Lightning, which goes along well with our theme of tons of 2-for-1s. Arc Lightning costs 2 and a red for a sorcery and deals 3 damage divided as you choose among 1, 2, or 3 targets. With Delver's dominance in the format, Arc Lightning is a formidable card. You can kill 3 fairies with this, kill a fairy and a Delver or a fairy and a ninja, or you can kill that single Augur of Bolas that's getting in the way of your Thorn of the Black Rose. Next, I'll talk about our Burn package, which goes along with the rest of our powerful interaction to keep us alive in the early game or allows us to kill an opponent through a fog if the game goes long. We're running 2 copies of Firebolt, which costs 1 red for a sorcery that deals 2 damage to any target. It would be strictly worse than a shock, but you can flash it back out of your graveyard by paying 4 and a red. We've also got one of the most famous pieces of burn and interaction in the Pauper format. It's Lightning Bolt. It costs 1 red mana for an instant that deals 3 damage to any target. Having all of these burn spells and interaction and two for ones, our deck is going to go into the late game, so we need finishers that go along with this plan. Our first finisher is Burn Buddy Thermo Alchemist. It costs one and a red for an 0-3 defender that you can tap to deal one damage to each opponent. That would be kind of alright on its own considering how many turns our games are likely to go, but whenever you cast an instant or sorcery spell, untap Thermo Alchemist. Throughout the game, we're going to be casting tons of instant and sorcery spells. Usually we can cast them again out of our graveyard, or we can just draw into more to cast with our Monarch ability or our Dark Bargain. We'll also be finishing our opponent off with 3 copies of Gurmag Angler, which costs 6 and a black for a 5/5 with Delve, which means each card you exile from your graveyard while casting this spell pays for 1 generic mana. When the dust settled after everyone realized how powerful other Delve cards like Treasure Cruise and Dig Through Time were, we were left with the Zombie Fish Gurmag Angler, a 1-mana 5/5 that can attack through anything in the format and challenge most of the format's removal. Okay, let's have a look at the mana base. First, we have 4 Bloodfell Caves. Your standard popper duels are going to enter the battlefield tapped, gain you a life, and when they become untapped, they tap for black or red. We've also got 2 Bazooka Bogs, great spell lands. They enter the battlefield tapped, and when they enter the battlefield, you exile all cards from target player's graveyard. Take that, Tron. We've got 4 Evolving Wilds, your popper fetches. You can tap them, sacrifice them, search your library for a basic land card, put it onto the battlefield tapped, and then shuffle your library. And our last non-basics are your red-black Karus, Rakdos Carnariums. They enter the battlefield tapped. When they enter the battlefield, you have to return a land you control to your hand. When they become untapped, they tap for black and red. For basics, we've got 5 mountains and 4 swamps, just enough untapped lands to hit a turn 1 Divest or Faithless Looting. The real power of our deck starts at 2 with Terminate. Alright, let's have a look at this sweet sideboard. First, we have 2 Duress for picking any spells out of our opponent's hand that we can't deal with Divest or Terminate. We have 4 Pyroblasts because we're also a control deck, but we don't have counter magic. If we're playing a deck with counter magic, we gotta bring some to the table. We have 2 Nihil Spell Bombs. We don't want to nuke our own graveyards with a Relic of Progenitus, and we can still draw a card off of this. We have 1 Reaping the Graves for those really grindy matchups. If our opponent is putting a ton of our creatures into the graveyard, they can storm off with their Galvanic Blast, but we just get everything back with this. We have 2 Evankar's Justice, great Wrath if our opponent is on all X2s, and we have 1 Electricery if they're on all X1s. We have 2 Beetleback Chiefs if our opponent is constantly trying to 2-for-1 us, and we just need a few bodies on the battlefield to finish the job. Rounding things out, we've got 1 more Chainer's Edict, because some decks are really bad at defending against them. And there it is, Rakdos Alchemist. We're going to take this deck live into a league at twitch.tv/anynewprovince this Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Atlantic time. We're there every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Atlantic playing possibly pauper playable decks. Before I go, I just want to remind you that you can like the video or subscribe to the channel down below. I'd seriously appreciate it. It's a great way to let me know you've enjoyed everything, and it really encourages me to keep making great pauper content. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this deck tech, and hopefully I'll see you on Tuesday night.